Namo Tassa, Namo Tassa, Namo Tassa. Compaghiamo le mani adesso, durante la nostra vacca, Chakshu Kundalikandena, Tasmai Shri Guru Namaha, Shri Chaitanya Guru Vishnu Stati Hamena Bhutta, Swami Bhutta, Dharma Yamada, Swami Bhutta, Shri Krishna, Chaitanya Guru Nityananda, Shri Advaita Gadadhara, Shri Vasudeva Gaura Bhaktavinoda,
Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare.
So we're beginning the seminar, which will continue throughout the next day, about 2 days, Saturday, Sunday, and half of Monday, on the Shikshastrikam prayers. And today we'll try to cover as much material as we can in the short period we have on verse number 1 and verse number 2. So let's all chant the verse together. Krishna and the Mood of Radharani. But Prabhupada said the most amazing thing. He said all the writings, he didn't say some, he said all the writings of the Goswamis, the six Goswamis of Vrindavan, are based on these eight verses. So we know Jiva Goswami, 400,000 verses, many, many great scriptures, the Sandarbhas, which are the king of all scriptures on bhakti. Sanatana Goswami's Briha Bhagavatamrita, Rupa Goswami's Nectar of Devotion, Ujjala Nuravani, many, many scriptures. Hundreds of scriptures were written based on these eight prayers. How powerful that is. Let's open your mind, the Supreme Personality of God. These prayers are so deep and so scientifically composed and so much full of the mellows of bhakti that will take lifetimes to try and figure them out. But just to learn the essence of some of these prayers. Of course, we don't have lifetimes right now. We only have this one. But we can make this one an endeavor to go deeper into these prayers. These prayers are so much connected with the holy name of the Lord that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur says something really, really interesting. He says, each of the prayers, which are eight prayers, are synonymous with the holy name. He says, the first prayer is Hare Krishna. The second prayer is Hare Krishna. The third prayer is Krishna Krishna. The fourth prayer is Hare Hare. Continue on. So each of these prayers are synonymous with the couplets of the chanting of the holy names of the Lord. How deep these prayers are. And the whole science, from the beginning of the time when a practitioner will make his entrance into the process of bhakti, until one reaches perfection, pure love of God, the entire philosophy is in these eight prayers. Like unraveling something that never unravels. You go, the more you go deeper, the more you find so much. But in essence, we understand that there's nine stages of bhakti. Adhaustrada, sarusanga, bhajana kriya, and arthanivritti, nishta, ruchi, ashakti, bhava, and prema. These nine stages are entwined in the philosophy of these eight prayers. And the acharyas have given us different correlations with these different stages of each of the prayers. And the first prayer is faith. In fact, some acharyas say the entire nine stages is in the first prayer. And others say, yes, but it's also in all the prayers. So, and we'll go through it a little bit to give a little more clear understanding. So, Lord Chaitanya, and I should also mention some other preliminary things. The science of bhakti, as described by Srila Rupa Goswami, is three categories. It's sadhana bhakti, bhava bhakti, prema bhakti. And each of those categories have categories within them. Sadhana bhakti is divided into two sections, Vaidhi bhakti, rules and regulations, and spontaneous devotional service. Bhava bhakti is the blossoming of one's emotional love for Krishna in the mood of deep, deep prayers and expressions of love. It's not the flower, it's the buds. As a flower grows, and the first sign of the flower's existence is the beautiful buds. And also, there is some elements of that flower in the buds. So, bhava bhakti is the emotional expression that is in the hearts of each and every living entity for Krishna. And the prema bhakti is the final conclusion. Now, bhava bhakti has six stages. Prema bhakti has eight stages. So the science of bhakti is not so much in the beginning, but it's very, very deep in the higher stages of bhakti. when one starts to taste and experience love of God, and then that goes unlimitedly deep into the rules of expressions and Krishna's relationship with the devotee, how Krishna relates. In these eight prayers, all that is explained. In these eight prayers, there is Sambandha, Abhideya, Prayojaya, which is, all the acharyas will conclude that the essence of the Vedas is made up of these three topics: meeting Krishna, serving Krishna, and getting the goal of that service, which is to love Krishna, ultimately. So, all these prayers, they're divided. The first five are in Sadhana Bhakti. The sixth is Bhava Bhakti and Attached Prema Bhakti, and seven and eight are Prema Bhakti exclusively. Now, the whole process, all these eight prayers, is Abhideya. And the last prayers are Prayojana, and the beginning prayers are Sambandha. So this is Mahaprabhu. I mean, who could else do that? When people say, well, he's not God, he's an incarnation, very powerful person. As soon as you begin to start to study this, you'll realize no mortal could put this together. It's not possible. It's so complete, so deep, and so full of Shastra. And it's his expression of his love for himself in the mood of Radharani. That's the most amazing thing about it. It's an ecstasy that he's exhibiting in the form of these eight prayers. I'll go through the first prayer so we can get a little idea of what this is like. Chaito Darpam Marjanam. Listen to there's seven benedictions of chanting and the holy names of the Lord that I mentioned. And each one is somewhat, okay, it's nicely listed here. Chaito Darpam Marjanam Bhava Mahadirvati Nirvapanam Sri Kaiva Vichendrika Vitara Nam Vidyavahu Jiva Nam Ananda Guru Varda Nam Pati Pradam Purnam Vita Swarga Nam Sarvatma Snapa Nam Param Sivaj Vijayate Shri Krishna Sankir Nam. Now who could do that? Each of the suffix ends with the word Nam, which is the name. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So deep. Just to give you a little literary embellishment of this prayer. It's so beautifully composed. You can sing it, you can dance to it, you can write it on your wall. It's a picture and it's also an expression of pure bhakti. So what is Lord Chaitanya trying to do in the first place? He's trying to establish our faith in chanting. So this particular verse is about faith. And how do you develop faith when you tell somebody something? That doesn't really, it may give them some interest in something. But how does their faith in what you say actually develop? That faith comes when you explain what you're saying as the benefit of that activity. It begins in that way. So Chaito Darpana Marjanam means to cleanse the mirror of the mind. The mind is considered to be like a mirror. It reflects inside what's outside. It reflects outside what's inside. No two people see the same environment in the same way. We see things similar, but according to our collective consciousness, and as expressed, according to the consciousness, I'm saying all our desires, our emotions, our experiences from past lives, as we live day to day, we perceive the environment or other people or different things in a different way. Each person has a certain reflective consciousness which is intuitive to their condition in the material world. Sometimes you say something, can't you see what I see? No, I don't see it. Well, try. Because it's just the way life is. But there is a subjective reality. That reality, which is completely pure and different from everyone's perception of reality. And Krishna explains, what is that perception? He says, when you thus have learned the truth, you will see that all living beings are in me, they're one. You'll see me in everything, you'll see everything in me. You won't see anything. You'll see the forms of this world, but you'll see me in the forms, and you'll see the living entities also within those forms they inhabit. The forms, they fade into the background, although they're visible. We see Krishna everywhere and everything in Krishna. That is actual vision. So if we haven't reached that stage yet, we have to work over it. That's the consciousness. That is pure consciousness. So in the meantime, the mind, which is part of the subtle body, reflects the reality that we see according to our consciousness inside. Prabhupada tells a cute little story on how this is. He says that there's an old man, he's sitting in his living room, and he's hard of hearing. He can't hear. His wife's in the kitchen, and she's cooking supper for him. He's sitting there waiting patiently for his supper, but then his patience changes. He calls to his wife, come on, hurry up, I'm hungry. Bring the food. She calls back, be quiet, read the newspaper, don't bother me. Something like that. Unusual domestic talks. And whatever goes on. And then after some time, he calls again. And again she responds in a similar way. And this time he says, what's wrong with my wife? I'm calling her and she can't hear me. He's deaf, and he can't hear her calling back, but because he thinks she can't hear, he's saying she's deaf. The mind. You get a little idea how the mind works. It reflects what's inside, outside. We, Atmanam, what is that? Atmanam, Amandake, Jagat. Everyone sees others, I think, according to their own understanding. So that is a collective consciousness that has manifested life after life after life after life. Well, the first benediction is Chaito, which means mind, Darpanam, which means mirror, and Marjanam means to cleanse. So the chanting of the holy name cleanses the mirror of the mind. When you look at a mirror that's full of dirt, you can't perceive the object that you're looking, that's being looked at because of the dirt. But as the mirror cleanses, the reflective power returns, and it's what you see inside is also outside, or outside is what is inside, like that. So that's when the mind becomes pure, and the mind is actually pure. It's called clear consciousness. As soon as we hit the material world, that consciousness becomes contaminated by material touch. The modes of material nature touches that pure consciousness, and then we start to identify with the body and the realities around us. So the chanting of the holy names, and this is put first, cleanses the mirror of the mind. It wipes away all the dirt and dust, and one can see oneself, and one can see Krishna also within that, what we say, pure consciousness. That's the power of Krishna's holy name. It's not simply a means for connecting with Krishna, it's a means for actually awakening our pure spiritual existence. Getting rid of the, what we say, And Prabhupada would say, mountains of dirt. The thing about Krishna consciousness, and if you haven't experienced this yet, then you should think about this. The more you make advancement, the more you realize how not advanced you are. If you think you're advanced, that's a problem. I mean, some of us might actually fall into that category by definition. But a devotee realizes the more we make advancement, the more I can see, we got to be able to see our own material contaminations or attachments. Sometimes we get a little scared too. But one should not be overly overwhelmed with that. One should think, I have to process the holy name. There's Krishna, and there's Krishna's name. Now, who's more merciful? Well, they're the same. So if you ask, if two things are the same, how can you make a distinction? But they also, they're same, and at the same time, they're different. So what is it about Krishna's name that is not completely, but what is the special feature of Krishna's name? Any guesses?
Mercy.
It's more merciful. Krishna says, you want my mercy? Chant my name. You're asking me for mercy? Here's the way to get it. So the name is more merciful than Krishna. That is his mercy. He puts his mercy in the name. So remember, the name establishes our faith in the process of God. The second one is Bhava Maha Devagni. Devagni means a forest fire, a blazing forest fire. Birth, death, disease, old age, the miseries of the mind, the miseries coming from other living beings, the miseries coming from higher powers, miseries. Prabhupada used to say, if anybody thinks this material world is a nice place, then you should know he's correct. Why? Because no one can stay here. There's a sign on the door of the material world. Everyone who enters here doesn't come out alive. So that's the nature of this world. It's just full of miseries. It's considered, Krishna says it in the Bhagavad Gita, Dukalyam Asasra. Okay, we haven't got it, so he says it again. Anityam Asubham. He says it twice. This place is temporary and miserable. We can't fulfill our desires. We're always overwhelmed by the material energy and things around us. And ultimately, whatever we achieve, we lose. Nice place. So, the idea is this material, and the material energy won't leave you alone. It is constantly scorching the living entity with various types of suffering. So a blazing fire is like something that is very dangerous. Mahadavagni. Prabhupada compares it to a forest fire. When you have a forest fire, how do you put out a forest fire? You can't call your fire brigades and all your trucks. They can't do anything. In America, many times, especially in the west coast of America, forest fires are quite frequent there. And sometimes the forest fires will blaze for months. They can't put it out. It'll destroy hundreds and hundreds of miles of forest. They try it, but they can't put it out. The only thing you can put out a firefighter is if you have a torrential downpour of rain. Then it can be put out. So this material world is compared to that. And what is that downpour of rain? The holy name. It's considered to be the means for putting out the fire of material existence. And Prabhupada said, if you're chanting Hare Krishna, you're engaged in devotional service, you're free from the miseries of this material world. We may get a little token here and there just to remind us not to go back. But ultimately, when a devotee is chanting Hare Krishna and is fixed in that chanting, then this material energy cannot touch them. It gives complete protection and it gives complete, what we say, freedom from any influence of the material energy. That's the power of Krishna's holy name. So that's the second benediction. The third is Sreya Kaiva Vichendri Bhakti Tanana. This is so Kaivava is a lotus flower, but it's a special kind of lotus flower. All lotus flowers bloom under the rays of the sun, but this flower blooms only under the moon rays. It's a special flower. It's very rare. Chandrika is like the moon. Shreya means auspicious. So, now the Acharyas give two different explanations of this body. One is that everyone has good fortune somewhere. It's hidden somewhere in our existence. Now, the holy name is that good fortune. And when the holy name comes onto the lotus flower of the heart, the flower is closed because the moon is not out, but the full moon is considered like cooling rays onto the lotus flower of the heart, which dissipates the burning and opens the flower's petals. And that flower, that petal, is our love for Krishna. It's a beautiful expression. We might use that example that when you offer a flower to Krishna, you're actually offering something really wonderful. And our heart is full of sweet love for Krishna, and it's like a beautiful, fragrant flower. But it's closed, or maybe not completely. And when the holy name comes, it opens up the flower of our heart, and we can offer that love to Krishna. This is the power of Krishna's holy name. Vidya Vidhu Jivana. I'm going a little fast because I know we might want to take time for questions. Vidhu means bride, Vidya means knowledge, and Jivana means life. This is a nice analogy the Acharyas give. The life of a bride is her husband. Vidya is considered to be husband. Vadu is considered to be the bride or the internal energy of the Lord. So when the holy name comes upon the living entity, it awakens that spiritual energy and gives life to that spiritual energy which is hidden in our hearts. And therefore, just like a bride is enthusiastic in the presence of the husband, the spiritual energy becomes alive in the presence of Krishna's holy name. Beautiful analogy. Who's the Acharyas? This is Shilamaki. I think this is Shilamaki Vinod Thakur. Both Shilamaki Vinod Thakur and Shilamaki Siddhanta Saraswar both comment on this verse in detail. So, the life of a bride is her husband. The life of our bhakti is Krishna's holy name. It gives life to transcendental knowledge. Vidya means transcendental knowledge. Just like when we perform activities, we don't just sit and have philosophy, right? Many spiritual movements, they sit and for hours they talk, and most people fall asleep, right? Prabhupada would go to these assemblies of these various spiritualists. They would speak for hours, and sometimes they'd be speaking in Hindi or a local language like that. And Prabhupada would be just there sitting, chatting, waiting. And then one time, after many hours of speeches, it was his turn to speak. He turned to the devotees and said, "Just have kirtan." And everyone got up, and the whole audience just went up, and everybody was dancing, and all the other sadhus left. And they don't like kirtan. They think it's sentimental. But the audience was inspired. Thousands of people got up and danced. And Prabhupada just had kirtan. That was his speech. So we don't do just philosophy. It's important, necessary. In fact, the life of our process is chanting Hare Krishna. Just like this weekend is very interesting because the devotees here, the youth here, are doing 50 hours of kirtan, which started yesterday. They did their first 12 hours. Today there will be 13 hours of kirtan. Tomorrow, 13 hours of kirtan. And Monday, 12 more hours for a total of 50 hours of kirtan. And that, when kirtan is there, as we were hearing some of the talks yesterday that centered around, the material world is gone. It's gone. So, transcendental knowledge, we don't just speak philosophy, we chant the holy names. In all our functions, it's about the holy name. We can have philosophy and a holy name, and we do that, both, and it's, well, both are needed. But if you have to choose one or the other, take the holy name. Because people had to go away with an experience. Okay, Ananda Buddhi Vardhana. This is deep. Ananda is bliss. Buddhi means deep. Vardhana means like an ocean. There's an unlimited ocean of transcendental happiness that comes by chanting the holy name. The Acharyas give a very interesting point. The jiva, us, we are known as infinitesimal. That means we are finite aspects of Krishna. We have his qualities, or some of them, not all of them. We have 50 of his qualities in minute quantity. But Krishna is the reservoir of all the qualities and all the characteristics. So we have those same, at least 50 of them, in a, what we say, a limited. But that limited is quite, not unlimited, but it's really up there. I'm not using a simple word. But one thing you have that is unlimited, and that is your happiness. There's no level of happiness that you can reach and say, the happiness a jiva can experience in contact with the holy name is unlimited as the ocean. When you chant Hare Krishna in the beginning, you feel peaceful. That's the first sign. Peace comes into our life. We feel somewhat satisfied. After some time, there's a type of happiness that comes through that. And then that happiness comes into joy. Joy turns into bliss. Bliss turns into ecstasy turns into bliss. Bliss turns into madness. Yep. And you become unfit to live in this world anymore. Yeah, that's the holy name. It takes you to the point where you become a madman and everyone thinks you put them away. This is the holy name. In fact, one can chant the holy name and experience so much happiness that you'll die from the happiness. We don't recommend you leave, but this is the power of Krishna's name. It can cause you to leave your body and happiness. And the Acharyas give a little example of how something is unlimited on the spiritual platform. And it's between Radha and Krishna. Krishna's there, and Radharani's there. And Krishna looks at Radharani and sees how beautiful she is. By seeing that, he becomes happy. And then Radharani looks and sees Krishna has become more happy, and therefore she becomes more beautiful, and therefore she becomes more happy. And then Krishna looks at Radharani and sees that she's become more beautiful, therefore he becomes more happy, that he becomes more beautiful. And Radharani turns back to look at Krishna, and she sees, oh, he's become even more beautiful, and she becomes more happy, and then she becomes more beautiful. Because happiness is a form of beauty. I don't want to sound weird, but you know, people who are not so attractive when they're happy, they're attractive. When you're happy, I mean truly happy, expressing, Yeah, all the apparent physical features, you know, take a background to that happiness. Because happiness is a form of beauty. So, you know, on a spiritual level, there's no limit to the happiness that one can experience in the chanting of the holy name. It's like a great, great ocean. Patipadam Purnamrita Swanam. This is interesting. It says that at every stage of the practice of Krishna consciousness, two things are happening. One, chanting the holy names. And in chanting the holy names, you're developing your spiritual body. In other words, you're becoming more and more aware of your internal mood. These are the higher levels. As we explained, this, the whole process is in this one verse. So these higher ones, these last ones, are the higher levels of bhakti. So patipatam means that every stage, one is experiencing transcendental knowledge, happiness, and awareness of one's internal relationship with Krishna in Vrindavan. And the acharyas explain that anyone who has come into our ISKCON society is more or less inclined to the mood of Vrindavan. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is attracting a certain class of people who have that inclination towards the mood of Vrindavan. Although we worship Sitaram, Lakshman, Hanuman, and we also honor very much Lord Vishrinya, but they're all in the mood of Vaikuntha. We worship that. But Prabhupada's process, Lord Chaitanya, is in Vrindavan Dham. So one who comes into this movement, he has the opportunity to reach that mood of Sri Vrindavan Dham, which is the highest level of transcendental loving exchange between Krishna and his devotees. So this Pratipradam Purnamrita Swadana, at every step, it's more and more closer to that realization, and at the same time, more and more realization of the glories of the Holy Name. And the last one, Sarvatma Snapanam. Sarva means all. Snapanam means path. It's a complete path. Your home, your possessions, everything related to you becomes purified through the chanting of the holy names of the Lord. In other words, not only you, but everything in relationship to you gets that same, what we say, element of purification. In other words, now it's not a matter of material consciousness and material things and spiritual consciousness with spiritual activities and spiritual paraphernalia. And then Vijayate Sri Krishna saying Param Vijayate. Param means victory. All glories, all victories. All glory, Srimad Vijayate, Sri Krishna Sankirtanam. It's like a victory call. It's an announcement. It's a declaration. Lord Chaitanya is just not saying something. He's declaring it. He's making it an orchestration. And it's this last line. So sometimes when we also, when we do the translation, we say all glories to the holy name of Krishna, which cleanses the heart. But then when you read the Sanskrit, it's the other way. When we do the translation, the last line becomes the first line, and then the actual sentence, the actual verse, that's the last line. So the declaration comes at the end, and at the beginning, two different, just like that. So this is the first verse. There's so much we can say more about each of these particular ones. I just gave a quick overview of that. Now, in order to take shelter of Krishna's name, we have to follow the process of bhakti. Bhakti is a process, and the holy name is the principle that makes the process powerful. But Prabhupada said, if you're chanting the holy names of the Lord, and you're not following the process that's given by the acharyas, he says you're cooking with smoke. tricorne. Ladies, you know that? Tricorne here with smoke. Thomas, come. Put a little smoke underneath your pan. Where's the dinner? It'll be here in 300 years. That's what Prabhupada said. If you're cooking with smoke, it'll take 300 years. So the holy name is the process, but it inspires us to take shelter of the process. And it's not separate. It's separate, but not separate. As we chant the holy names of the Lord, we develop faith in the principles that come by way of the benefits of the holy name, and then the process becomes what we say natural for these. What is that process? To follow the acharyas in how to approach Krishna's name and execute devotional service. Okay, so this is the first verse. I can say a few more things on this. Lord Chaitanya, I'll just mention this, is a beautiful verse in the first Hare Lila, chapter 4, verse 40. Lord Chaitanya has taken the Sankirtan movement and he's made a garland out of the holy name. And he's strung this garland in a very beautiful way, and he's taking the garland and he's putting it on the whole world. He's garlanding the whole world with what? Radha Bhakti. Radharani's love for Krishna in the form of the Sankirtan movement. Therefore, it is explained that the chanting of the holy names of the Lord in Kirtan and Krishna dancing with the gopis in Vrindavan is non-different. It's non-different. Because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is God and Krishna, and all his associates are also manjaris or gopis coming to assist him from his spiritual world. There's no difference between Sankirtan. Now Sankirtan, I'll give you another little interesting. The word Sankirtan, sometimes we understand San means what?
To be
honest.
Together.
And what's the other one?
Complete.
Complete. This is the word, this is the particular definition that's not so much known. San means complete. And what does that mean? There is no more complete way to worship the Lord in this age than to perform sankirtan or kirtan. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Sarvadharma Pradikshachaman, just surrender to me, give up all your ideas on how you can make an advancement. That's what he's saying. You think you know how to perform devotion, forget it, just surrender. That's all. And then, nobody did that, Prabhupada said. Krishna was too difficult. Okay. He's a hard guy to deal with. Makes it too difficult. Surrender. Give up all your own ideas. And Prabhupada said, he was wondering, it didn't work. Not too many people took him seriously. So, alright, I'll come back and do it again. Alright, don't worry about surrender. Just chant Hare Krishna. Take some prasadam. So in other words, he made the same process of surrender easy through the chanting of the holy name. So the surrender to Krishna in this age means to become attached to chanting Krishna's holy name. There's a kind of attachment that comes with chanting. We have to develop that attachment. So by hearing the benefits of the holy name, especially in this first verse, we can understand how much we can achieve simply by chanting the holy name. All the benefits are there. Seven major benefits, which include all the benefits that one can achieve, both materially and spiritually, from chanting of the holy name. Any questions on the first verse? Yes, Mother D.
You said that when someone says something about us, we speak also for their realization and what they see. Because we tend to see others according to our own conditioning.
Yeah.
So that goes then for if someone praises you or if someone condemns you. We have to take it the same. Because sometimes there's praise and sometimes it's condemnation.
There's an old saying, praise and blame are only different in name. Praise and blame are the same, only different in name. No one can hurt you by blaming you. It's the false ego that gets hurt.
Ooh, you said that. Why did you say that to me? Who do you think you are? Don't you know who I am? You know, you get me. Who's that person? He walked right by me and didn't even notice me. How do you go? So we get a little disturbed on how people, we expect things or we get things we don't want. Either one. I think Sonika Rishpagul was saying yesterday, he was talking about the third verse, that it's very difficult to come to the platform of not expecting respect for yourself. We'll speak about that. That's the class later on this morning. That's at 12:15. We'll speak about the third verse of the Holy Name. Shikshastika. So it's difficult because when we give respect, we expect respect. Or if someone says something. But the Acharyas actually, when Krishna was criticized, by, different persons, Sushupal, Pondraka, and others, they just turned that, the Acharyas, or the goddess Saraswati, the Acharyas understood that when they condemn the Lord, they're actually praising the Lord. So we shouldn't take it so seriously. We can learn from something. If someone criticizes you, you can think, oh, maybe there's some fault in me, maybe I can correct myself. You can take it as an opportunity for learning. It depends. If it comes with somebody who's really close to you, the closer the person is to you, the more it hurts. If a stranger criticizes you, kind of let it go. But the closer you are, that's why it's important that in Vaishnava society, devotees be very, very sensitive and very careful to always keep good relationships with all Vaishnavas. Never find fault. Because when it comes within the family, and this is the spiritual family, it's difficult to accept. There's a verse in the 11th canto, 28th chapter, verse 1 and 2, says that one should not criticize another person and one should not praise another person. Why? And then the second verse says, because according to the modes of material nature, in relationship to the activity of that person, one is seeing faults and criticism accordingly. And as soon as that material energy, the Acharyas explain, as soon as that material energy changes, you see things differently. So therefore, what it's saying is that fault of praising and condemning are wrong, because you can't see the whole picture. But then, the Acharyas go on to say, but you can praise. Because it's natural to want to glorify and extol one other person's good qualities. But to criticize and condemn is the process of the humans. Does that help? Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, Prem Murthy?
Maharaj, you were speaking about benefits of the Holy Name, but you can explain the difference between Kirtan and Japa, because we find that Kirtan is very easy and Japa is very hard. And yesterday the speaker said that, can you just explain a little bit on that? What is the more beneficial?
So Prabhupada has given us the process that chanting the holy name comes in two forms. It's actually, there's three things. Manasi japa, which is chanting in the mind. And then there's soft japa, which is kirtan, and loud japa, which is, not loud japa, but glorification of the Lord in relationship with others, is sankirtan. So the process, Lord Chaitanya did both. In fact, it's explained that when he would chant japa, he would always chant in front of a tulsi plant. And even if he was walking, he would have someone carry a tulsi plant in front of him. He was chanting japa. He would always like to chant against him. The tulsi is very auspicious. Tulsi purifies the mind and helps one to go deeper into chanting of the holy name. So Lord Chaitanya did both. He chanted japa and he chanted the holy name. He chanted kirtan. We hear mostly about his kirtans. And I've heard from different devotees that by chanting japa, it increases your enthusiasm for kirtan. And by chanting kirtan, it helps to increase your quality of japa. In other words, they help to support each other. Okay. You have to chant japa. It's difficult, of course. Why is it difficult? Chanchala himala krishna kamati balabhadruha tasyaham nivavam maye vayurana suduskara. The mind is restless. Doesn't stay in one place for long. And likes to go from place to place. So when devotee asks Prabhupada, I can't control my mind when I chant. What is this mind? Just listen. That's what he said. Just listen. Just try to hear. So there's an art that we can adopt in the process of japa and kirtan. But ultimately, we have to access the mood of bhakti in order to perfect our japa and kirtan. Yeah. So your question is?
What's more beneficial?
Because
Chita Shakti Mataji said yesterday, the experience with japa, when somebody has some support with the verbs, it perturbs the mind and it also has a negative effect for them. But the kirtan is really calm.
Prabhupada Jayate Sri Krishna Sankirtan. Everyone benefits by kirtan, sankirtan. Why? Because even when Lord Chaitanya asked Haridas Thakur, how will the non-moving living entities benefit? He said, by the loud chanting of the holy name. So the trees, the creepers, the insects, and whatever, you know, unseeable living entities we have in this room, when you chant, they're benefiting. Kirtan. So we might say kirtan is the Yuga-dharma. But chanting is part of the process of our given by the acharyas and especially Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It's not indispensable. You can't just push it aside and say, I'll just do kirtan. You won't get the mercy. Why? Because it's the instructions of the spiritual master. It's the instructions of the acharyas. Yes,
Since hearing the holy name is so important, what happens to persons who are born deaf?
Yeah. There's a few programs now to teach deaf people how to chant. Does anybody know about those? Yeah. People are shaking their heads, yes, yeah. They have a system for teaching deaf people how to chant the holy names. I think Erbola, my god sister, she was involved in going to a few places to help with that project, teach people how to chant who are deaf. When I started going to India, I met one young man who was also deaf and couldn't speak either deaf and dumb. But he would mouth the holy name. They can read it. They can read it.
Visually.
Visually, yeah, visually. Vishnu Barakuda?
I just just wanted to support your point. You get the right answer to Prabhuji. I don't know your name. What's your name?
Prabhumurti.
Prabhumurti. In the Harinam Chintamani, there is a kind of same questions asked, you know, what is more important, japa or kirtan? And according to Bhaktivinoda Thakur, that he says, you know, the goal of life is to achieve the samadhi of the holy name, which is Kirtaniya Sadahari. And he says, it doesn't say Japaniya Sadahari. So Kirtan is actually for everybody, but not necessarily the japa. You know, some people may find it very difficult. But once you achieve perfection, then this mantra upasana, Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, means the pastimes of Krishna, they become manifest in your heart, along with the kirtan. Kirtan has different melodies. And Shiva Maharaj was giving, you know, the old explanation, which made a lot of sense. So kirtan is actually more therapeutic.
And if you're chanting kirtan, you'll also be enthusiastic for japa. You can't say, well, I'm just going to do kirtan. You can, but after a while you lose your taste for kirtan. Because the mercy of the whole domain is coming by through the process of the acharyas. The acharyas don't give that as an option. Chant. When Prabhupada was asked, what is your most important instruction to your disciples? He answered very directly, my most important instruction to my disciples is to chant 16 rounds on beads every day without fail. That's an example. So, therefore, it's not only an instruction, it's the most important instruction. Following in the line of Srila Prabhupada, we all adopt that, those who are also spiritual masters adopt that same principle. Japa. Thank you. Anything else? Any other questions? Yes.
Further question. Sometimes the Buddhists say you cannot advance unless you're in the presence of someone more advanced than yourself. Other people say, no, even if you don't have the association of self with your soul, you can advance by taking shelter of the holy name.
I don't know why there's the two philosophies in our society. I don't know which one it is. Which one do you think it is? I don't know. I vastly go from one to the other. I don't know why I get the association of Vaishnavas. You chant the holy names, Sankirtan, it's together association. There's some persons who have read books and adopted just the chanting Prabhupada's books, never met a devotee, and actually started to develop that. But after a while, they're really, really eager. Because I preach in jails. And so that's one good example, is that they get Prabhupada's books, and of course they correspond to someone by mail, but they never actually physically were in the presence of a devotee. And then after a while, it's really hard to keep them going unless they get a chance to associate with the devotee. So we try to have programs inside and go and see them. They need that. But initially, we can get connected through Prabhupada's books, through the holy name, through prasad. These are all connected. Sarusanga, sarusanga, sarusastri hari, bhagavanta sarusange, sarusastri hari. Now one moment's association with the pure devotee, and one can become free, completely free from all material contamination. That's how powerful association is. Very powerful. So we look at Prabhupada said, someone asked Prabhupada, no, Prabhupada said this. There are three things that are important in the process of executing Krishna consciousness. Association, association, association. Write that down. It's really in that order. I mean, it's like when you're in association, you get happiness. When you're in association, you get purification. When you get association, you get knowledge. You get so many things in association. Association is so powerful and so uplifting. Color chocolate? Yes.
When you say Kirtaniya Sadhari, does it refer only to Kirtan or Kirtan by default it means glorification? The Prabhupada glorified in books and we gain service by people, that is also your glorification. So
directly
Sadhari, you so give it Kirtaniya Sadhari.
Yeah, Prabhupada actually said, I'm typing on my dictaphone, that was also chanting. But because in the principle of spirituality, these things are simultaneously one and different. So a glorification of the Lord is the activities of bhakti. And the ultimate glorification of the Lord is the Yuga Dharma. So both are glorifications of the Lord. But you have to do the Yuga Dharma. Yeah. So it's different and non different. But if you say, well, I'm not going to, you know, I'm just going to kirtani sadahi by eating prasadam. It's also kirtan, right? Because it's Krishna and I'm honoring Krishna. But, no. You have to actually follow the acharyas. This is one of the things. Mahajanam yena katasa panta. If we don't do that, then the process of bhakti will not give us the result. We have to follow in the footsteps of the teachers who are giving us the process. We have to learn the process and follow their direction. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati had his followers chant 64 rounds. And Prabhupada reduced it to 16 for us. So you might say, wow, Prabhupada made a mistake. No, he's the acharya, he's establishing the standard for him. Because he's authorized and therefore he can adjust what we say principles according to time, place, and circumstances. But they don't adjust the fundamentals. They might adjust how the fundamentals are executed. Instead of 64 rounds, 16 rounds. Does that help?
Yeah, when I raise this point, I put it in like some of the purpose of the rights I don't put. Vyasadeva was chanted in writing.
Yeah.
For nine purpose rites. So even many times he said that when I am writing books, I am actually glorifying Krishna.
Yeah.
So the Sadhavari, I mean, I cannot do, of course, I cannot do 24 hours a day all through my life, just simply Kirtan alone.
Mm-hmm.
So that Kirtan is Sadhavari, I mean, I'm just asking for clarification. It refers to all kinds of activities throughout the day that we are doing, to be for the Godhead.
And that verse specifically. The first
of
all,
yeah.
Specifically, because all the explanations of that verse all end with the chanting of the Holy Name.
Hmm.
Anything else? Parosha? Yeah.
You mentioned that Sankirtan means a complete process, that Kirtan is a complete thing.
Think about what you meant to say. Think about it.
So Kirtan is complete in itself.
Complete in itself.
Yes. As I heard that it's better when someone also preaches, not just does his bhajan. So I was just curious if there is a connection between kirtan and preaching.
Preaching is a form of kirtan, because it's glorification of the Lord. It says that each of the many of the different services are understood. Preaching is considered to be the mood of the gopis, or the mood of the manjaris. Our process is Manjari Bhava. We are in a mode of assisting the activities of Radha and Krishna. That's our mood. That's Lord Chaitanya's mood, to be an assistant for the pastimes of the Lord. Not directly take part in it, but to make arrangements for Radha and Krishna to have wonderful pastimes. That's our service. To bring Radha and Krishna together through our various types of services. So preaching means to bring another living entity to Krishna. And that's what the Manjaris do. They arrange for other living entities to get the association of Krishna. So that's what preaching is about. It's actually Manjari Bhava. When you're actually preaching and bringing people in, you're in the mood of the gopis. Because their mood is to give pleasure to Radha and Krishna by bringing others into the association. Anyway, does that help? Yes. Mother Leela Shakti?
We are going to open the gate for the gopis to go to the hall at 9 o'clock.
Prashad is at 9:15, right?
Yes, but it will take about 5 minutes from here to walk. And the gates will be open at 9 o'clock. So
we have a ceremony?
No, we have to be very quiet when we go there because of the villagers. So.
And can't we go after breakfast?
Breakfast is at the hall.
At the hall. Okay, so we go after class.
Yes. 9 o'clock, then we open the front gates.
Okay. I don't know. Thank you for the public service announcement. Yes, teachers?
Hi, Krishna. Thank you for the talk. You mentioned that Bhaktivinoda Thakur said that each verse of Sri Chaitanya corresponds with the two...
Yeah, the couplets.
Couplets of...
Yeah, there's one book written by him, and he mentions that.
Okay, so I got a bit confused about this. Because this verse is about the whole process of Krishna consciousness.
It's encapsulated in that first verse. It's the 9 stages of bhakti are found in those 7 elements.
Okay, so...
That's one interpretation.
So how is it that this verse is related to only... Hare Krishna.
Oh, I see your point. Because in Hare Krishna, the entire process is there. Hare Krishna, Radha and Krishna. Can you get any more complete than that? If you said Krishna, then it would be incomplete without the energy. But Krishna is always with his energy, so it's always Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Okay?
Thank you.
Let's see, anyone more? Yes, Prabhu?
Thank you, Shabbat. You mentioned about criticism and praise in your talk, and how we should, as devotees, try to cultivate good relationships within the devotee community and not criticize others.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking that. If you could elaborate on how we should deal with the devotees who are senior to us, those who are equal to us, and those who are junior to us, so as to cultivate a positive atmosphere.
There's a verse, and his question is how to relate to people who are senior, equal, and in a lower position, according to you. There's a verse. Does anybody have the...
Dhruva Maharaj's pastor.
Yeah. Anybody have the... It's 4834. 4834. I want you to read the verse that way you'll give it a better answer. I can paraphrase it, but I think reading it is actually the way to really get the full meaning of the verse.
From Narada.
Yeah, it's from Narada. And this is Sri Guru Maharaj is getting instructions from Radha Muni. Anybody else got it beforehand? Take the fastest.
Yeah.
Okay. Read it. Nice and loud.
Just English or Sanskrit?
Just the English, yeah.
Every man should act like this. When he meets a person more qualified than himself, he should be very pleased. When he meets someone less qualified than himself, he should be compassionate toward him. And when he meets someone equal to himself, he should make friendship. In this way, one is never affected by the three cold mysteries of this material world.
Purport really is good. I mean, it helps to bring out the point even more. Yeah. Nice and loud.
Generally, when we find someone more qualified than ourselves, we become envious of them. When we find someone less qualified, we deride them. And when we find someone equal, we become very glad of our activities. These are the causes of all material tribulations. The great sage Narad therefore advised that a devotee should act perfectly. Instead of being envious of a more qualified man, one should be jolly to receive him. Instead of being oppressive to a less qualified man, one should be compassionate toward him, just to raise him to the proper standard. And when one meets an equal, instead of being proud of one's own activities before him, one should treat him as a friend. One should also have compassion for the people in general who are suffering due to forgetfulness of Krishna. These important functions will make one happy within this material world.
So by following this, one becomes free from all material suffering, just by following that principle. Respect and honor and be pleased to meet those who are more compassionate. Make friendship and share that friendship in Krishna consciousness with those who are on an equal platform, to those who are, what we say, on a lesser platform, or maybe new devotees or just people in general, trying to bring them up exactly. Fourth canto, eighth chapter, verse 34. Very important verse. It's the foundation for how to relate to everyone.
Table yellow, another see blue or something like that.
How we perceive.
And I have a question regarding this. How to, what is more important, like to accept what this person means and respect this, or how to react on this?
You have a difference of opinion on to how you see and how someone else sees, mm-hmm. how to keep that relationship from going down. Mm-hmm. Discuss it. Oh, you see it this way, but I see it this way. Yeah, but if you do it in the mean spirit, and you can voice your opinion, but how you voice your opinion is really how your opinion is accepted or not accepted. I mean, there's a way of debate. There's one type of debate where you just destroy the other person. It's called, I forgot the word. It's a real heavy word. But you don't talk about the subject, you just criticize the other person until you destroy their character. And that's not the way to debate. That's one form of debate. People use that. But that doesn't get to the point. So, difference of opinion? Discuss. I mean, when it's serious, then you have to remain the authority to iron it out. But always keep, you know, we can say we respectfully disagree. It's not like you have to agree with everybody. It's not natural. Respectfully disagree. There's some people that say, I'll end the class on this. Everyone's entitled to my opinion. Everyone's entitled to my opinion. The phrase is everyone's entitled to their own opinion, right? That's what we're supposed to say. Well, sometimes we don't mean that. But take the opinion of the acharyas and spiritual masters, and then we can understand how we can formulate our opinion based on what we hear from them. It's called Shastra Chakshu, seeing through the eye of Shastra, or Guru. Okay, thank you very much. So, Buddha Bhagavat Prabhu will be giving the second talk at 10:30 in the, what's the name of the place? Something Hall?
Religion
Hall at 10:30. And in the temple, there will be, starting at 10 o'clock, second day of kirtan. Thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada Ki Jai. Shri Shri Sixth Nasthikam Ki Jai.